गुड मॉर्निंग मोनिंडल, वेलकम फॉर अटल स्पॉन्सर्ड 1 वीक फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम ऑन साइबर सिक्योरिटी एनालिटिक्स। टुडे वी आर एट द लास्ट डे ऑफ आवर FDP। फॉर दिस मॉर्निंग सेशन आई रिक्वेस्ट नटराजन सर टू टेक ओवर द सेशन। नटराजन सर, नटराजन सर, सर गुड मॉर्निंग सर, सर गुड मॉर्निंग सर,
Hello, I am audible now, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Actually, there was a problem with my headset. Sorry.
Sir. Morning, morning, sir.
Okay. So, good morning, all. Now we shall continue our discussion on cyber analytics. Specifically, my last session we were focused on machine learning based solutions for cyber security issues, right? So we discussed in that aspect, and hope you got your got the programs and the required data, and hope you have practiced it. If you have any issues, let us discuss in the last part of today's session, right? And today's discussion will be focused on two main aspects here. One is federated learning, and another one is a differential privacy scheme, right? So before getting into those two topics, let us understand the overall process in case of an machine learning model training, right? So earlier also we have discussed this, but little in detail we will now discuss that same, and we will continue into the the topic discussion, and as well as we will see a program demo on federated learning. Just a simulated program, right? Environment. So to begin with, right? In any machine learning model training, specifically, first of all, what we need to do is we need to collect the data, right? So once we collect the data, right? And we will do, as discussed earlier, we will do little pre-processing, then some feature selection or whatever the transformation. Or maybe like as we discussed, synthesizing more samples, that is generating more number of samples out of few observations. So and then we will go for modeling now. Now in this one, once we do complete the training process, the output of the training process, always we discussed that it is the coefficients or the parameters of the model. Now thing that you have deployed, we have deployed our trained model in some target space, and it is being executed, and it is catering different people's need. Now there is a higher probability that it can be reverse engineered, right? So through the or from the available weight parameters and the model architecture, it is possible to know the distribution of the data used for training, and as well as we can able to get the sample that is used for the training the model, specific model, right? So this is more vulnerable, right? This cannot be this is not for example, when the data is being contributed, or the data is a confidential data, or it is more private data of different users, then exposing the model to the general public, right, will lead to leakage of the data, right? Through a reverse engineering process from the known model architecture and as well as the weight coefficients, it is possible for a hacker to retrieve the data distribution used for training, and as well as he can able to synthesize these samples also, right? Through a reverse engineering process. So now this is where the problem starts with, and also like mostly when we have this kind of application where we want to develop a model to mimic the behavior of different users, right? To be, mimic the behavior of different users, the users themselves will not share their data, their private data. So in majority of the time, for example, many applications when we install in our mobile app, so they will ask like, would you like to send statistics report to the server or something, like they will ask few questions. So by default, for everything it will be yes, right? So majority of the time we may change that into no, right? So what will happen in this kind of applications are, right, once we enable them, the usage statistics, or maybe for example, let us consider that I'm using my credit card, right, for some UPI payments, right? So in that time, what will happen is, my frequency of utilization, to what kind of products I'm purchasing, and to on which platform I'm specifically doing my transactions, and what is my bill amount. So everything, right, everything can be, these are all private data. So when these data has been shared to the server, right, from different users, right, not only from a single user. So think that I'm centrally sitting in, for example, I don't want to name any UPI app, right, maybe XYZ, let us call it as. So I'm sitting in the end of an XYZ UPI app, and I'm collecting all the users' data, and I'm developing a machine learning model to mimic their users' profile right now. Now, I could be able to sense like which user will be spending at what time. I can able to guess that one. So depending upon that, I can able to push my promotions or notifications, right? This is a very sensitive data, right? I can utilize this for my promotion even though the users are sharing it with me. But if I develop a model using this data and expose that model to the general public, there is a high likelihood that the data privacy is being lost here, right? So a perfect example in this case is like closely around some years back, right, a decade back, more than a decade back, Netflix, what they had did is they released a data set of their users rating depending upon different parameters, right? So they what they have done is they anonymously released the data. They have not mentioned anything about the user details. They have released it, but few hackers or researchers, what they did is they took data of the users from the IMDb and other stuffs, and then they could be able to match with this the data released by Netflix, and then they can able to recover nearly 90% of the users' data. So this is vulnerable, right? So this is where the problem, this is what the problem in machine learning model actually. So when we collect the data into a central server and we do the training of the model, and then we release the model along with its architecture and its reach coefficient. So the data which is used for training the model can be estimated through a reverse engineering process. This is what the problem, what is being faced now. So to avoid this one, different solutions have been proposed, but the very the best one and the emerging one is a federated learning. We will discuss that in very detail. So a similar kind of approach we follow, right, federated learning, the similar kind of approach we follow in the area of big data analytics particularly. So many of you have already exposed to the world of big data, wherein, like, for example, if we take a framework like Hadoop, when we have a large volume of data, right, in the general, right, in a client server based computation environment, right, so the data will be always available in the client end, and the server holds the computation resource and as well as the program. Right now what happened is the client will push the data from its end to the server, and then the server will do the computation. Let me present my talk so that right. So whatever I'm briefing it now, so all that are available as sort of text information within this notebook file. So I'll be sharing after this session end. So you can just refer it, right? So now in the conventional client server based environment, what will happen is the client will push the data to the server, and the server will do the computation, and then the results will be shared in back to the client. This is what will happen, right? So in this arrangement, what is the major drawback is that the movement of data, right? When the data is in volume, right, when the data volume is very high, then moving the data from client to the server itself will be very, very expensive here. So to avoid this one, what people have done is this model, what we call it as data around the code. Actually, the code will be central and the data will be moved from the client to the server, and then it will be further processed in the server end. So this is what the model, conventional approach used. And later on, when the large scale data analytics have been geared up, what people thought is like the data movement itself is expensive, and they want to cut down that expensive process. So what they did is they developed a solution like code around data. So instead of moving the data from client to the server, the data will reside in the client space itself, and the code from the server will be sent to the client end, and it will be executed locally, right? So then there will be a question like whether the resource available in the client will be sufficient or not, right? So now, for example, when the data available within a client is an individual client will be less volume, when we collectively see all the client's data, then it will be a huge volume of data, right? So now to overcome this one, right, what happened is the code is being pushed to the client end and it is executed locally, right? So this is very similar to a distributed computing environment, right? The results from individual clients will be sent back to the server, and the server will aggregate the result, and then the results will be communicated back to the final result will be communicated back to the client end. So this is what will happen in case of big data analytics. So here, since the data movement is expensive, so people started following this kind of arrangement. But now what we are going to do is the problem what we discussed earlier is since the data is being shared from the client end to the server, and in the server space the modeling is happening, and when the model along with its weight coefficients are exposed to the general public, then there is a high likelihood of data leakage here. So to avoid this one, what can be done is the data will be residing in the client space itself, right? So the model architecture will be pushed, model will be pushed to the client, and it will be trained in the local space itself, in the client space itself. And once it has been trained, right, the individual clients will push their training output, that is their weight coefficients, right, to the server, and the server will do the aggregation of the individual clients trained one. Now, so the advantage here is the data privacy has been retained, right? No one knows what was the data used for training the model except the client, right, individual client. So this process what we call it as federated learning, right? A federated learning is like similar to a distributed modeling process, where the client data will be residing in their space, in their mobile or tab or whatever it is, their edge device, right, their edge device itself. And the model training will happen in their edge device itself, and only the trained output, that is the coefficients of the model, right, that will be pushed back to the server, and the server will do the consolidation, that is what we call it as aggregation of all the weight parameters here. So this is a very simple arrangement, right, to be implement, but there are a lot of intricacies in that. That is what we are going to discuss, right? So one by one we will be discussing that. Before getting into that, we will discuss what is the term differential privacy is. So I hope you will be able to see my notebook screen, right? Right. So when we want to do a statistical analysis or any machine learning modeling on a sensitive data shared by different clients, right? So there are three components that are involved majorly, right? Here one is the sensitive data from the client. And the data curator, that is the the server or the central the station which is collecting all the data and doing the statistical analysis or any modeling or summarization of the data, whatever it is. And the adversaries, so these are the adversaries are the parties who are trying to based upon the report or the statistical analysis or the summary of data or from the model which has been developed on the sensitive data, right, using these information, right, along with the other information, right, so other information, they would like to do a reverse engineering process what is the actual distribution of the sensitive data and as well as what is the data actually it is, right? So these are the three parts, actually components were involved in this differential privacy scheme, right? So that is what actually it is in the first set of statements what I have given here. When we try to curate or manage a very large sensitive data collected from different clients of an application or any other portal, right, we need to guarantee that the data does not being exposed to the adversary party by an reverse engineering process, right? So the solution for this right is to enhance the security and the privacy of the data is the differential privacy scheme, right? So using this differential privacy scheme, what can be done is the sensitivity of the data can be preserved actually, right? Right. So generally speaking, right, so what we said is like through a reverse engineering process, they can able to retrieve the data used for training the model. That actual data they can able to find it out. But that is also not a easy process. That itself is lot many troubles are there. But still, it is doable, right? As I said, one example in case of Netflix, it happened. But a simple solution instead of a differential privacy scheme, right? So a simple solution can be anonymizing the data, right? So that is what we will think of. So what we will do is we'll take the data from the client and we will make it as anonymous so that nobody will know that this data belongs to, even though the data they are able to retrieve back through the reverse engineering process, they will not be able to find out like this data belongs to who, right? So then that is easy solution that can be help to preserve the data, right? But if they have the auxiliary information, as I said, the Netflix example, through the DMB, IMDB auxiliary information, they could able to find out like this set of data belongs to whom, right? They can able to map the users of IMDB to the data available in hand with them, right? So again, so these are the method and adversary party will use to recover or know in detail about the data, right? So even though a simple anonymization will help us to preserve the privacy here, but we require a sophisticated solution like differential privacy scheme or algorithm, right, to maintain the resilient of the data, right? Right. So how do these algorithms work? These differential privacy algorithms, how do they work? Is, for example, now think that I have collected large volume of data from individual client and I have summarized it and I have made it as a report now. So think a scenario given here is I have collected lot many statistics from different credit card users and I have placed a summary, right? In the summary, the things available are the rating of the customers, based upon their profile and as well as their payback capacity or whatever it is. Now in this summary, I have categorized the users as good, normal, bad, right? So the number of good users, number of normal, number of bad users, I have displayed in my portal, right? So I have the data. I have not exposed the data. Only the summary of the data I have exposed now, right? Now think this one in this fashion, right? For example, if this data has been exposed to the people, right, for some adversary party, they can able to get this information, right? Who's payback capacity is poor, so they may be the target, or they may be made vulnerable, right? So are the normal or good profile customers maybe getting into trouble, right, when I expose this data, right? So what I will do is, for example, I have the summary report, I'm not exposing the data, and I'm making an arrangement that if anybody wants to know, they can query and get the results from this report, right? For example, think that this report has a table. I have preserved the table, right? So if anybody wants to know like how many bad customers are there, right, so they can just query the data and then they can get the results. Now along with the query result, what this differential privacy algorithm will do is it will add some noises. It will add some noise to the data so that the end result that is reaching to the adversarial end is not the complete one or incorrect one. For example, here, someone is placing a query. So how many bad rated customers are there, credit card users are there? So then the actual answer is 3. So instead of returning 3 to the as a query result, what this differential privacy scheme will do is it will add some noise to the 3, right? And then it will give the result to the people so that they will not know the exact one, right? So that is how we preserve the sensitive data using a differential privacy scheme, right? So this is a very simple example for our understanding we have considered. But you can think this differential privacy scheme when we have, sensitive information like bank balance or the credit limit, what they have in balance. So these kind of sensitive information that should not be exposed always. And even some third party, they legitimate third party, then what they want to know about this one, a small amount of noise will be added to the query result, and then it will be exposed to them, right? So right. So how much of noise that will be added here? So it cannot be a random always, right? And there should be some predefined mechanism. How do we estimate the noise that has to be added to this to this result specifically? And the amount of noise that I am going to add will also depend upon the type of function, right? For example, in case of the number of bad rated customers, right? So it is like a count one, right? So how many customers are bad rated, right? It is like counting, right? So the total worth of the total sum of money deposited by a group of employees in a bank, something like these are all a summation operation, right? So the amount of noise that I am going to add to the result, it should depend upon the type of function that is being performed here, either counting or summation or multiplication or any other operation, right? So the basic idea is to add a random noise to the ground truth, right? That's a result, right? So for example, we choose, how do we estimate this noise, right? Let us see that. Choose a random number L, right, from a zero centered Laplace distribution, right? And the distribution will have a standard deviation of 2, right? Now I am going to select a random number L, right, from a zero centered Laplace distribution which is having a standard deviation of 2, right? Now this L is my noise now. I am going to add this L with the ground truth, actual result, and I am going to give this as a final result to the adversarial party, right? So this is what we call it as this algorithm, what we call it as a noise counting, right? See, for example, if you could able to see that distribution Laplace distribution, right? It is zero centered, right? It is zero centered. It is symmetric, right? It is symmetric on both sides, right? So the left and right will be, half will be symmetric. For example, when the query, right? For example, different people are making a query on the same, like the number of bad rated customers, right? For example, even as a single person making multiple number of queries, or multiple people are making the same query, we can think over on the same different scenario. In any of this one, the response what will be generated for individual query will not be same. Why? Because the L what we are adding with the ground truth is being chosen randomly from the Laplace distribution. For the first time, it is the result is 2.915. Second time, and the same query is being executed, the result is 1.882. The third time, it is 1.292. Fourth time, 4.026. Fifth time, it is 5.346. Right. So each of that time when we run the query, right, the ground truth value n is same, right? It is 3. But the noise, that is L value that we are adding to the actual value, right, is not same, right? Between different execution now. So the n person will not be receiving the same response, right? But what can be happening here is, so I am trying for more number of query, right? I am an hacker. What I want to know is, so I know that they have used some differential privacy scheme here so that I am not getting the exact answer for a single query. I know that one. So what I am doing is, I am running the same query for n number of time, right? So once after n number of time, if I take an average, right, now what is the average value here for this 5 different query attempts results is 3.090. The actual value is 3, which is very close to here, right? So now what is the problem here is, I have devised a solution, right, to preserve the sensitive data, right? So the approach is, along with the query result, right, I'm not going to fetch send back the actual result. To that result, I'm going to add some noise. The noise I'm choosing based upon some random distribution, right? So for example, one query, one or two attempts, I have preserved the sensitive data, but there is a trial being happening here for a frequent for a series of query, the same query, right? I'll be returning different responses to the person, and the average of all these response could help them to reveal the actual ground truth, which is even not the exact one, but still close to that one, right? So that is the drawback of this, still the drawback of this approach. And what can be done further to prevent this one? Let us see it further, right? So this is what things what we have discussed now. The first answer, 2.915, which is close to but not equal to the ground truth, right? So the person who is getting the responses not able to find out what is the actual result, right? But after multiple attempt, through averaging, simple averaging of all the responses, they would be able to find out that, right? So more and more number of queries, the privacy is breached here, right? So, but what can be the average value is 3.090 here, right? So still 90% confidence interval, right? With this 5 queries, is itself is a quite wide here. So the minimum value the confidence interval is 1.696, and the maximum is 4.484, right? So the confidence interval, what I meant is like an estimate computed from the statistics of the results, actually the responses fetched from the query, right? It gives us a range of values for an unknown parameter. So here the unknown parameter is our the mean value here, right? So the mean, what we can guess is like it can be ranging from 1.6962 4.484, right? So we could able to this is a wide range. Actually the actual value is 3, but the minimum value what can be identified by an adversary attempt is like 1.696. the maximum what they can able to find out is 4.484, right? So few advantage here is like by adding a random noise, we made it harder for an adversarial attempt to breach the privacy, and it is very simple to implement, right? So that is no much complex mathematics involved in it. So simply from a Laplacian distribution, we are taking a random value and we are using that random value to sum up with the result, and then we are displaying it, right? So what is the drawback here is more and more queries, the attempted person could be able to approximately estimate actual value, right? So still with up to this one, is this concept is clear or if you have any query, let us discuss. So you can just communicate to us through your chat window. If you have any queries till this part, so you can raise through your chat window so that we can discuss and we can move on to the next one, because this is very simple, but still if it is not clear or the concept is if it does not reach the right, so then we shall discuss it one more time and then we will move on to the next level. Hope it has reached all the people, right? So let us move on to the next one. Right. So as per the mathematical theorems, right, for example, if we increase the variance of the noise, right, which has been added to the results and given to the adversaries, right, we can able to defend our data, right, preserve the data in a much better way, right? So that is what the mathematical theory says, right? But simply adding a Laplace noise to a function, right, we want to make it more concealed, right? So as I said, the noise that we are adding to the result should be having a dependency on the function type of function what is being adapted also, right? For example, the counting function what we have used, right, the count function, right, the number of bad rated customers is simple a count function, right? For example, I have all the customers records with me, and in that customer record, think that there is an attribute called rating, and if the rating below a certain level, then they will be rated as bad. Now what is that I want to find out is count all the records whose rating is below certain value, right? It's a simple count function, right? The sensitivity of the function is 1 actually, because if I add or insert a new row, right, the sensitivity will be changed by 1 actually, right? So for example, if I introduce a bad rated customer, automatically the number of bad rated customer will increase by 1, right? So that is what the sensitivity of the count function, right? Now for example, I have a function f which I have defined it on over a data set d, right? Now how do we define the sensitivity of f, right? So sensitivity of f equal to the maximum difference between one row that can have on the result of the function for any data set, right? For example, think that I have two different data set, right? I am applying the same function on the two different data set, and what could be the maximum difference that I can have, right? that is what the sensitivity of the function, right? See, for example, this is what, you know, the algorithmic approach, what we will be adapting in our differential privacy scheme, right? So we have a function, right? And the input to us is x, and we have an one constant value epsilon. What is it? We will discuss it later, right? And the output, what we are going to generate, is a noisy answer, right? So the process is like, we are going to estimate the noise, and we are going to add with the f of x, right? F of x plus noise. That is what we are going to give it as an result, right? So now to find out the noise, right? What has to be added with this f of x? We have to find out the sensitivity of f over this given input x or the data set, right? So then we draw a noise L, right, from a Laplace distribution with variance by using this formula 2 multiplied by S, that is the sensitivity divided by epsilon whole square, right? So this is what the noise L that we will be adding to the f of x now, right? So what we are returning is f of x plus L. So L is equal to 2 multiplied by S divided by epsilon to the whole square, right? So when the sensitivity, right, is larger, the noise will also be high, right? So that the end result will be more anonymous to be the person who are trying to hack down, right? So here the epsilon is referred as the privacy loss, right? By tuning the epsilon level, we could be able to control the noise that we are trying to introduce here, right? For example, when the sensitivity is high and the epsilon value is high also, then the noise what we are trying to add will be less only, right? When the sensitivity is high and the epsilon level is very, very low, right, then the noise what we are trying to add will be very high, right? So this is how, by tuning the value of epsilon, right, we could be able to control the noise. For example, in case of Apple, that is iOS, an epsilon value of 2 is being used, right? Right. So there are two terms here that we need to understand: what is a privacy budget and what is privacy guarantee, right? So when an attacker or a hacker is making more number of queries, right? So what we have seen is from just a simple averaging of all the query response, they could be able to get a close approximate of our the actual data, right? So that's a great drawback what we have discussed. How do we counterfeit that, right? So what simple mechanism what we can follow is the data curators, that is the host, what we the host of the data can enforce the maximum number of queries that can be executed by a user, right? So if the number of queries exceeds the threshold level, right, what we observed is the privacy is becoming weak, right? So beyond the threshold level, we can stop answering the queries to a particular user, or still, if the query is from a different number of users regarding the same question, right? Same query is being posted by many number of users. We can stop answering queries to the people to preserve the privacy of the data, right? So the maximum privacy loss here is called the privacy budget, actually, right? The privacy budget what we are losing, right, because of this leakage of data through a repeated number of queries on the same data set, right? So that is what we call as maximum privacy loss, right? Each query here is a expense to us, right? The costing for our privacy expense it is. Whenever query is being posted, after sending the query response, we are losing the sensitivity of the data, to a little certain extent actually. That is our privacy expense. Like as how we are expanding after every activity. Like here, this is a privacy expense, right? So because of this privacy expense, what is happening is the privacy loss is getting increased. And once this privacy loss, right, it reaches to a maximum value, right? So at this point, we are going to freeze answering queries now. So this is what we call this entire, this logic is nothing but a privacy accounting. So these are the different terminologies and simple procedure of differential privacy scheme to ensure that sensitive data is safe when we are curating or managing a large volume of information collected from different clients actually. So the concept is very simple, right? So what we are trying to do here is when we have the summarized version of the data collected from different clients, and when we have a situation where more number of queries are from the adversaries, so what we are trying to do is to the query results we are trying to add in some noise so that they will not be getting the actual actual sensitive data. By doing so, we are preserving the privacy of the data, but still after a repeated number of attempts, right, a simple averaging of all the query response will help them to estimate a very close answer. So to avoid this situation, what logic we are following is the curator, that is the host, can stop answering queries when the number of queries exceeds a particular threshold value, right? So the mechanism here what we follow is called as a privacy accounting, right, in which the privacy loss is incurred whenever a query is being placed by an adversary on the sensitive data, even though the result is not the actual ground truth, but still, right, it is making the sensitivity of the data to be lost after another query in series, right? So this is what differential privacy scheme actually, and the major part here is the return is f of x plus l, and the l depends upon the sensitivity of the function, and the sensitivity of the function, how do we are estimating, that we have seen. So any queries on this complete one? A kind request to all the participants, right? We are not seeing face to face, and delivering from one end is little tougher, and also like listening to this kind of lecture is also tougher for people, but still if we make it little interactive, it will be more easier in the both the end, right? So with this kind request, right, if you have any queries, please let me know. Right, so with this one, right, we'll move on to the next topic, that is federated learning, right? So as we discussed, I just want to repeat that in any machine learning modeling process, right, especially with this training, right, so what is focused is taking actual data and then applying it to the model, and during the training process, generally we know that when we do train a neural network, what was the algorithm that we use is a gradient descent based approach, right? So stochastic gradient descent is the algorithm, that is optimization algorithm, majority of the time we use, or adaptive momentum, which is also based upon your stochastic gradient descent only. Whatever the optimization algorithm that we use in neural network training, that hails from only this stochastic gradient descent algorithm. And the output of the training process is nothing but the weights or the parameters, right? Model parameters. So the model parameters are nothing but, as I said on the day, when we have a neural architecture, right? So we will be having few layers of neurons, and each and every layer will have some number of neurons, and the first layer will be connected fully to the second layer, right? So here the architecture is dense, right? Fully connected, no kind of methodology we will adapt in neural network, and the weights is no the value are simple a resistor kind of, right? So that is being for example, right, when we have a connection between first layer to the second layer neuron, right, so the output of the first layer neuron will be passed to the second layer as an input, right? So now here we want some resistance, right? We cannot apply all the input to flow to the next level, right? So we can consider these weights as some resistors here, right? So weights as some resistors to the our inputs here, right? So the output of the final no the training process is nothing but the no weights or the model parameters, what here we call it as. So when these weights are known, right, finding out the actual model sorry actual data used for training the model no is not a big issue here. So we can easily a reverse engineering process can be adapted no to estimate the actual value. Once even if not a complete value, if no people are able to better understand the distribution of the data itself, then it is vulnerable one. So this is the drawback here, right? So always it is no yeah hurdle for no machine learning people to collect the data from people. So what is the scenario here is quality data is available in all the edge devices no used by no our users of an application, right? Be it our no airline reservation systems, or maybe like any e-commerce platform, or maybe any stock no trader, wherever it is, right, wherever it is, so the potential informations are available at the no user end, right? So if we able to as an no the business end, right, as from the business end, if we could able to collect these valuable information from the user, we could able to no infer lot many no statistics actually. See, for example, there is an allegation being made like from the sensitive informations collected from the Facebook no profiles of different users, the US election, you know, the trend in US election was changed drastically by a company, right? So that cases and all we have seen, right? So that is what the potential of no the data which is available in the no customer end actually. So now this federated learning is a mechanism for connecting a different machine learning model no regardless of their location, and more importantly without breaching the no privacy of no that data available in the client end actually. So what we are going to do here is we are going to structure the model, right, in the curator end, and we are going to send the model to the client, and the individual client who is holding the data will do the training in their local space. They are not going to share the data, right? Rather than taking the data to the model for training, right, that was the conventional approach, right? This federated learning methodology takes the model to the data instead, right? As how we have discussed in the case of a big data analytics, instead of moving the data from the client to the server for computation, right, in case of big data analytics, right, the code will be moved to the client end, right? The client will be in a distributed fashion, right? So when the code is being moved, the no the time or the resource used for no transferring the code will be very less, right? Because the code volume is very very less when compared to it is negligible even compared to the data volume, right? So I just going to move the code to the client within a seconds, microseconds, and once this is have been done, the individual client is going to not do the computation now, right? So the server need not do the computation. So then no, this is what the no arrangement in a big data scenario, right, analytic scenario. The same kind of approach is being adapted here in this federated learning, right? So this FL algorithm takes the model to the data instead, right? So what is the essential part here is the willingness of the user, right, the or the owner of the edge device to permit the model get trained in their local space, right? So by majority of the time when we do install an application, there will be lot many points to consider, and then at the last they will say like I agree, so and so, so and so. So within this, these classes will also be included, right? So when we read lines to line carefully, then we can able to see that, right? So they will be using their our data to model behavior of user, or the the mindset of the user, or the choices of user, or whatever it is, right? The preferences of the user, all this they can able to model with the data that is being available in the edge device actually. See, this attempt, what I have told you, maybe if I want to precisely say a particular application, right? So this kind of machine learning model, right, by collecting the user data, where we can use it? We can use it in the case of taxi booking, in case of applications like Uber, for example. I have a customer who is using Uber continuously to book taxis on his working hours, working days actually, working days actually. So all the statistics, right, whenever he has, when he has booked through what kind of mode he has paid, how much he has paid, or maybe like some sensitive information like what timings he has used, all this if we collect in central, right, collect centrally, and we are doing a model, right, to predict when next his booking will happen, right, to predict in this case, for example, I have developed a model and I am using it. If the model falls in hands of some people, and right, if they are getting a reverse engineering, if they are able to get, right, the data like when they have booked, what is the timing they have booked, all this, if they came to know, it is, right, it is a very, very vulnerable, because if I came to know that when a person will book, there is a chance of life threatening to the people, right? So I want to preserve this data. So instead of taking or collecting this data to a central repository, what can be done is this data can be residing in the edge device itself, right? We need not to do any aggregation, right? So simply it will reside in the edge device itself. Now I have the model structure, and the model structure will be sent to the each and every users of my application, right? So the modeling has been done, and I'm collecting the individual model, right? Then I'm doing an aggregation of the weights only, right? So what will be sent from individual client now is the weights after training the model on their own data. They are not giving us the data, they are training the model on their own data, and they are sharing only the weights to us. So what we are doing in the central or the server station is we are collecting all the model weights, right, individual models now. And then what we are doing is we are doing an aggregation of all the weight. Aggregation is simple, nothing but averaging of all the weight values here. So once we do an average and we estimate the final weights, we can just use that model for predicting when a particular user will be making us the next booking, right? So if we able to predict when he will be booking a next, right, for example, I have predicted today that tomorrow my customer number 10 will be booking a call from this place to this destination, right? Then now, for example, if there is any call from I can able to give a call to any taxi driver to this route or nearby to their location, to my customer 10 location, on the next day on so and so timing, so that I can able to connect my driver, that is cab driver, and as well as my client at this particular timing. So this kind of predictions, right, will help us to service our customer, right? Service our customer in a very sophisticated fashion, right? So this kind of arrangements, right? So that will help us when we need to model the behavior or there is a power interruption here. If you are not unable to hear my voice, or if please let me know through the chat window. Right. So this is a simple scenario what I can give it to you to use this kind of federated learning approach, right? So as we discussed in an differential privacy scheme, there will be three part there. One is the sensitive data, and the second one is a curator, and the third one is an adversaries, right? So here in this federated learning architecture, right, we'll have a curator and a server here. Curator or server, right? So that's is the central part, and it coordinates the total training activity, right? So client are the nothing but the edge devices, right? So in this training process, these edge devices communicate with the server minimum two times, right? So so first time, right, maybe like we will be pushing from the curator the model and the global weight. Actually the global weight we would have estimated based upon the data what we have, or the synthetic data what we have, right, or some benchmark data set, right? So the global model weights and as well as the model structure, that will be architecture that will be communicated to the edge device the first time, right? And the second, right, it will be trained, right, in the local edge device, right? And the model parameters will be updated, right? And then these updated parameters will be uploaded back or sent back to the curator. So this will be a repetitive process. If the accuracy or the the level of the confidence of this model has not reached up to a higher level, right? For example, I'm sending the global model. I'm doing the training in the local end on day one, right? So till now I have only very few data available with the local device, in the edge device. So the model accuracy will not be efficient. So what I'm doing is, after a week time, right, I'm doing this again, the training process, right? So now what will happen is the edge device data, right, some more data would have been added between this time, right, every time, and the training again when it is happening, the model parameters will get updated and the model efficiency will increase now, right? So as how we are continuing the model training for more number of epochs in our conventional approach, we do this this federated learning, right, repetitively until we reach a saturation level or a higher accuracy level as expected. So the similarity between the big data analytics approaches, instead of moving the raw data, we are moving only the weights, right, which is very very volume wise, which is very very less when compared to the raw data. So this is a schematic view of federated learning process. The local data resides in their space. So the model, the one way, it's a two way communication. From the curator end, the global model and its weight will be sent to the local edge devices. There the model training will happen, and the updated parameters from the edge device will be communicated back to the curator. This is what a simple federated learning mechanism is. So any queries on this one?
No sir, please continue.
Thank you sir, thank you so much. So now, now what we are going to do is, now we are going to simulate a federated learning environment here, because we don't have 10 different client devices who is going to give us the data. What we are going to do is, we are going to take a data set, and we are going to divide the data set into 10 different sets, and then we are going to use these 10 different sets to do the data modeling. So this is very simple to data stratifying actually. We'll see that. So we are going to use a data set called the MNIST. Many of you would have already used this data set for your machine learning process, right? Learning process. This MNIST data set, what I'm going to use is a handwritten digits data set, right? So where I have 10 category of classes, handwritten digits, right? 0 to 9. So total 10 classes we will have. So all this handwritten, will be taken as an image, and each image will be of size 28 by 28, so that 784 pixel values total we have, right? So once we have this data set, right, I'm going to take this data set, divide them into 10 different clients or some 5 different clients. So, and from these, what we are going to do is, the data set, we are going to divide that into 5 different pieces, and individually we are going to do the modeling. And once finally, what we are going to do is, we are going to do an average of all the individual model weights now. So after training the model in the client space, we will be getting 5 different or n different models. The n is nothing but the number of clients, how many number of clients we have here who are doing the modeling process here. So once we have this n number of model, what we have to do is the individual weights divided by n. That is what we are going to do. Sum of all the weights, the corresponding weight parameters. For example, if we have 10 weight parameters, now what I will do, so the weight number 1 from all the 10 clients, I will sum up divided by 10, right? So weight number 2, sum up of all the clients divided by 10, that is n, number of clients. So this is what will give me the final updated weight values, right? So after averaging, I'll be getting 10 different weights now. So that I will use for further predictions, right? So that's the process we are going to adopt here, right? So I have told you about the data set, and what the model we are going to use here is a neural network here, right? So let us see that, right? These are the few input statements that I will execute. And I'll share this data set, I'll share this code. Before to that, I'll brief on the, So these are the code which I have commented, right? For example, the data set is available in the Kaggle platform, right? Now we are using the Google Colab environment, right? So for example, let us think that what conventionally we do is, we will download the data from the Kaggle, and the data will get downloaded into our local desktop or laptop or any server. Then we will upload that into our drive. Then we will use the code to work on the data. So instead, what we can do is directly we can download the Kaggle data set into our Google Drive. Any Kaggle data set we can download into our Google Drive. If you want me to brief on this part, please let me know. I will brief it for very quickly. I'll brief it up. How to directly get the data from the Kaggle to your Google Drive. Or if you feel like these are all very simple, we can able to proceed with, I can skip off this and I can move on to, okay. Let me brief on this one. See, for example, how do we work in this cool collab environment is, for example, this is my, See, I'm sharing my drive now. For example, this is my drive folder where I have my this notebook file, right? Now parallelly, what I am going to do is I'm going to create a folder within my Google Drive, and I'm going to dump from the Kaggle all the data, whatever I want, that is the images, whatever I want, into this MNIST folder. Then I'm going to access this MNIST folder from my program. This is what I'm going to do. So in any Google Colab notebook, what you have to do is you have to first mount your drive to this notebook, meaning that so to this Google Colab environment you are mounting. So when for example, to open a even this one also I can tell you, because many people So how do we create a notebook here is, for example, within this your drive, you can just right click and you go on to this Google Collaboratory, right? So right click and then create a new Google Collaboratory. So automatically a new notebook file will open, and just here it will be mentioned as untitled some 0 or 1. So you can just change your name by clicking on this space, and then you can change it up. Right. So what we have done is, first initially we have created a new notebook file in our Google Drive page, and then for example, if we see here, we could be able to see our drive here, files are actually right. So initially our drive will not be mounted here. For example, this is the three one, right? Here this is the third icon. If you click on that one, initially it will be mount drive. It will show us already I have mounted it, so it is showing us unmount drive again, right? For example, I have revoked it now. If you just click on this one, I am unable to connect it. Okay, connected now, right? Now you could be able to see that, for example, if you see this files right tab here, this is the mount drive. If you click on this mount drive, right, it will access for your permission connect to Google Drive, right? So to connect to Google Drive, we have to run this two lines of code. Automatically these two lines of code will be inserted in our Google Colab notebook, right? If we execute this code, what will happen is it will ask for an authorization code actually. So what we have to do is we have to go to our this link, right, where it will ask us if what is the from which Google account we have to give this authentication, right?
So excuse me sir,
please ma'am,
that window is frozen, we are not able to see.
Oh sorry. So this is what I was referring to, right? So initially our drive will not be mounted into this notebook. So you have to go to the file section here, wherein we will see this mount drive. Click on this mount drive, so it will ask you for your permission connect to. It is mounting our drive, right? So otherwise many times what it will ask you is it will insert the two lines of code, right? When you just run that code, right, it will take you to a window where you have to give your Google account ID and password, then it will generate a key, right? And that key you have to paste it here. For example, let me check, because already as I have mounted it, So in my area, it is raining here from yesterday night, and there is a frequent power cut, and I'm not able to connect to my broadband. I'm connecting from my mobile. If there is any audio or other issue, please let me know. So now when you click on this one, I'll just directly I'll type down this code and then I'll So, you're able to see this. These two lines of code will help you to mount your drive, that is Google Drive, along to this notebook. So just click on this, right? Execute this code, right? So it will give you a right link, and it will ask you to enter the authorization code. When you click on this link, it will take you to right. I'll share the page which it is redirecting us. Right. So now what will happen is it is this page it will redirect to us when you click on the link. So just you choose the account which you want to and give all the allow or the rights. Then it is generating a code. Copy this code. Right. Copy this code. Come back to your. I think you are able to see this, right? Copy this code and come back to your I'm just pasting the code now and enter. My drive will be mounted here. You're just able to see this one drive, my drive. Within this, you can able to see all my this is the actual cyber security machine learning. This is the actual directory which I have stored all my code and as well as model. So this we could able to access. This is how we have to mount our Google Drive within this one. Right. And directly, if we want to download the Kaggle dataset into our folder here, we have to use these files. Right. Now, to begin with, first what we need to do is we have to go to the Kaggle platform. Right. For example, I'll stop sharing this page and I'll go to the Kaggle page and then I'll show what to do. See, for example, I'm just going to this home page of my Kaggle that is visible to you, I believe, right? Whatever the data set you want, you navigate to that data set. See, for example, this is what the data set I have used here, right? Now to download this data set, or whatever the data set, you know, whichever you want to download to your Google Drive. First, what you have to do is you have to get the API key from the, you know, Kaggle. So in the account, right, whenever you have logged in with your account here, no Kaggle account, right, go to the accounts tab here, right. I think it is visible completely, whatever I'm narrating it to you now, right. So scroll down. In the last, you could be able to see that, no, two buttons, expire API token, create new API token, right. When you click on this expire API token, what will happen is, you, when, if you have previously, no, downloaded any API key, that will be expired. And then what you have to do is you have to create a new API token. When you click on this create new API token, it will download a JSON file actually. It will be named as Kaggle.json, right? So the name of the file, what it, you will be downloading is Kaggle.json. With this, no, your Kaggle part is over, right? Then what we have to do is, then one more thing we need to get from this Kaggle is, after downloading the key, right? So within this competition page, for example, to download this data set, they will give a command actually. That command where it will be available is copy API command, right? Within this button here, if you click here, it will show like copy API command. Just copy it and for example, I'll just paste it here. So this is what the command, Kaggle datasets download -d. This is the name of the source folder and this is the one. So this is the Kaggle command that we have to use it to download this data set, right? So now what we have done is we have downloaded the API key and we came to know that what is the API command here, right? Now we will go back to our Google Colab notebook. From there we will see. Right. Now once the first two lines here, right, from Google Colab dot import files, files dot upload. So what we need to do is we have to upload that Kaggle JSON file to the Colab now, right? These two lines will do that one. So when you run this files upload, right, let me just show you. Already I have done that upload, right? When you just run this port, it will ask you to write choose the file and upload, right? From your local one, you can upload it to your Google Drive here, right? So choose file and go to that Kaggle that JSON, select that one. I have it in my so I have here one. Select this one and upload it. So once you do this upload, that will go to the root directory, right? Now what I'm doing is, if we don't have a right, I'm doing an interruption because I'm not going to execute it. Already I have done that one. Right. The next line, the third line here is pip install Kaggle. It will install the Kaggle package, because we are going to run the Kaggle command here, right? So we have to install this Kaggle package within the our Colab environment. So pip install is the pip is nothing but your package manager in Python environment. So install -q Kaggle. If we run this script, this code, it will install the Kaggle package. Then next, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a directory, within the root folder called the Kaggle. And to this, I'm going to move the JSON file. I'm copying the Kaggle JSON to this Kaggle folder, which is created in the previous steps. The next one is I'm going to execute the Kaggle, API command, which we have taken here, right? So once you execute this command, what will happen is your data set will be again downloaded to your root one, right? It is the root is here, content, root directory is /content/minist as jpeg.zip. It will be downloaded as a zip folder, zip file. Then what I'm doing is using this copy command, I'm copying it to my directory here. My directory path is this one, right? Cybersecurity machine learning. So content/drive is the mount path. /my drive, right? Cybersecurity machine learning. Within that, I have a folder data. Within that, I have a folder MNHT. To this, I'm going to move that zip file, right? So the downloaded file is available in the root, and from the root I'm moving it to my directory, right? If it is available in the root, we can able to manipulate the data and we can able to work on the data. But when we close that notebook file, or unmount the drive, the root folder will be erased off, because that is not our drive actually. That is not our own folder, right? That will be available just only until we have mounted it. Once we unmount or close the notebook, that will erase off, right? Next time when we mount the same drive, it will not be available. So we have to move the file to our own folder, right? So then I am unzipping it using our unzip. I am unzipping the zip file to, again, this is the destination folder, right? So this is the set of code, that we have to use when we want to have our Kaggle data to be downloaded into our environment. This I have executed once, and I have my data with my space. So I just want you to I have commented it. When I am sharing this to you, please uncomment and then explore this for the very first time. And this is not a repetitive process, right? So this one also, right? Whenever you have, you need to mount, execute these two lines. Next, we'll move on to the code blocks, right? So the first code block define load here, right? So what it will do here is, it will, it's an utility function basically. What it will do is, we have our all, once we unzip, right, we have two folders. One is for training and another is for testing. We know that, right? That is what the arrangement in Kaggle will be always. So now what I have to do is, I have to read all the images that are available in the training folder. Then I have to give it as an input to the model for training. That's the usual process. To do so, it is an image, right? I have to read one by one. An image, as I said, the dimension is 28 by 28. So I will have 784 pixels. What I am going to do is, if I want to give this image as an input to neural architecture, we cannot give two-dimensional input to the neural, right? The input layer will accept only a single row of value, right? So what I am going to do here is, I'm going to transform this 28 by 28 size image pixel data as a, if it is a grayscale one, we will, it is a 28 by 28 size only. If it is a RGB value, right, that is a color image, the size of the time, the image will be 28 by 28 by 3. Now we have grayscale images. So 28 by 28 is the size. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to resize that or transform that into a single row, that is 784 values, right? So once we read that and transform that is in the 784 value, then in my input layer of my neural architecture, I will have 784 neurons, which is going to accept all the 784 values. Then further, first hidden layer, second hidden layer, third hidden layer, this is how I will have the neural architecture, right? So to do all this, reading an image, right, and converting the grayscale into binary, or doing a normalization. I told you, like, to avoid regularization, overfitting, we need to perform, the first step is scaling or normalization, right? So all this one by one, step by step, it will be performed by this utility function. For example, what is we are passing to this function is the path, right? So the once we have a folder, we could able to retrieve all the file names, that is image file names that are available within the folder, right? So that is what will be available in this path list. This path is a list that contains all the path of the the complete path of the image files that is available in my training folder, right? Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take one by one from this path list, and I'm going to read that image, right? I'm going to flatten that image. That is what 784 we are doing. Then I'm going to find out what is the label, right? So for example, in the training folder, for each of the category of class, I'll be having a separate folder. For example, all the zero images will be kept in folder zero. All the 100 images will be kept in folder one. Likewise, so for each and every class, I have a separate folder, right? So the label of the path I can use at the label of the image, I can able to retrieve by taking the, you know, a substring of the path information, because the 0 or 1 or 2, whichever is the label for that one, is the directory name, right? So if I get that one, I can get to know what is the label, right? I'm reading the image and I'm retrieving the label, then image by 255. This is what scaling actually. So this is what a min-max scaling operation it is, right? So in min-max scaling, also we have discussed this yesterday. When we have a range of values, then we can use this min-max scaler, and the minimum value here is 0 and maximum value is 255. So min-max scaling formula is x minus x min divided by x max minus x min. Here as the minimum value is 0, so 0 will not have any impact, so we have neglected it. So directly we are dividing it by 255, which is the maximum value. So now we are appending that data, image divided by 255, that is one image divided by 255 to the data list, and as well as a label, we are appending it to a common list. So likewise, we will read all the images that are available in the, for the 10 different category of images, we will read one by one, and then we will know what is the image and label, and we will put it in a one common list now, right? So this is what this utility function will do, right, for us. And then here, as I said, like, this is a simulation environment, so we don't have the actual edge devices, right? Actually, I'm running out of my laptop battery, so I don't have a power connection here. Just give me 2 minutes, I'll arrange for a temporary power, and then I'll get back. Just give me 2 minutes.
So what we have discussed is, am I audible now? Please.
Yes. Sir, you are audible, sir.
Thank you. So what we have discussed is like we're going to simulate a federated learning environment here. So we don't have actual edge 10 devices. So what we are going to do is we are going to take the data, we are going to divide that into 10 different parts, right? So this create client, right? So is a utility function that will just create some 10 or whatever the numbers we are giving, that many number of clients, and they will assign each client with some name, and whatever the image list which is available with us, it will divide that into 10 or it is like simple, like data sharding, it will perform that one, right? So when we see the code here, right, so it does nothing like whatever we have the image list and label, we will be shuffling it, then we are going to just split that into 10, and then we are going to assign a name to the each of the partition. That is what we are going to do, right? This particular utility function. So this is nothing but like we need batch data. Whatever the training we follow here is a batch based, oriented data. Batch oriented training. So at each time we'll be passing on a batch of data as input to the model, right? So to get batch of data, this particular function will be used. And this is the model what we are building here, right? So as I said, like input shape will be 784, right? The first dense layer is going to have 200 neurons, and the activation function what we are going to use here is a ReLU activation function. You can check with sigmoid or tan, so what will be the result or impact, you can just analyze, right? But we will not be using softmax in our layers, right? So in the second layer we have 200 neurons. And similarly, we are using a ReLU activation. And in the last layer, dense layer, that is output layer, we have 10 neurons, right? That is the number of classes what we have, right? Activation function, what we use is a softmax. So this is our model architecture, right? So, and this is our federated learning logic being implemented here, weight our Stirling factor, right? For example, so what we are going to do here is local count divided by global count, right? For example, if we have 10 clients and if we have some total 10,000 records collected from 10 different users, each person is contributing 1,000, right? So then the scaling factor for individual client here is 1,000 by 10,000, right? So that is how we will find out the scaling factor for their individual contribution. We'll scale their contribution depending upon their weightage, because the person who is giving more, right, should be more records should be given more weightage, right? So that is how the weightage mechanism will work for. Then we'll scale the model weights, right? So once we have the weights, we will scale it, each and every individual weights we will do scaling, and then we will do summation of all the scales here with this function. Define some scaled weights, and this is for testing the model, testing the accuracy of the model, right? I think the load function earlier we know this one. Already we have seen the load function, the same one I have deleted it. As we have made it two times, I have just copied it one more time, that's why I deleted it. So this is the actual driver program. What we have done here is we will give the training folder path here, right? The complete path for the training folder. It starts from our content drive, my drive, cyber security, all this it will come up. And then using the list, path.list images, right? What we are doing is we are listing out all the image, you know, whatever the complete path of the individual images that is available in 10 different folders within the drive, right? Then I'm reading one by one images, right? And I'm taking the image list and the label list. Then the label binarizer, it is nothing but transformation of your label values, which are in values like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? 10 different classes. That we are transforming into a one-hot encoded form, right? So for example, 0 will be represented as 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. 1 will be represented as 0, 1. Rest all the index will be 0. So each and every label will be converted into a one-hot encoded form. The length of the one-hot encoded form is equal to number of classes, right? So for example, the label 2 will be encoded as 0, 0, 1. Rest of all the 7 positions will be 0, right? So the corresponding position alone will be 1, rest of all will be 0. This is the one-hot encoded form. Then we are doing a trying test split, and then we are performing the node training actually. So this part of code, right, this wave, for example, whenever we just do read the from the images, and when we want to save the the images in the form of a NumPy array, we can use this. Otherwise, you can skip out this one. So this is like after reading every image file, we will be getting image set. We will be getting an array, right? That is X prime. Corresponding labels in Y prime, X test and corresponding Y test, right? So if we don't want to save this, keep out this, or if you want to save that as a NumPy, NPY file, right? So you can use this code. So the total number of images that is available in my directory, because when I was downloading, my download stuck in when I was downloading the third category of image itself. So in total, I could able to get only 11,145. But if you really completely download it, it will be more than 40,000 images. I downloaded 0, 1, 2, only 3 categories I downloaded. So this code is also already been available, but anyway, right? Just we'll see what we are going to do. Now we are going to run this create clients function so that we can able to create 10 different clients now, right? So this data is also been already batch data already we have discussed, right? So once we have created the clients, right? So then what we are going to do is we are going to slice our data, right, into 10 sets for testing them. So this is the MLP function. So we'll have this clients like this, 10 different clients we have, and this is the driver function now. So we are going to create a global model, right? And the input shape for the global model here is 784, 10, right? 784 is the input size shape, 10 is the output size shape here, right? Because we are generating a one-hot encoded representation, right? And what we are going to pass to individual clients is the global weights, and from the individual clients we are going to receive their updated or trained weights here. So for each line, what we are doing is we are calling the model fit function, right? And we are setting the weights as global weights initially, then we are calling the training function here. So already we have divided the batches here, right, for based out of our training samples. For that particular client, right, from the batch array, we will be passing that data alone, right? So you can continue this for from 10 or 20 or 50 epochs, depending upon the size of your data we are feeding into the client, right? And keep the verbose always as 1. So that we can be able to see what is happening during the training process, right? So this is what how we push the data to the client and do the training, right? And once you are after training process, right, you'll be scaling the weights, updated weights. Using these three lines of code. First, we will estimate the scaling factor for the client. Then we will scale the weights, and then we will append it to our scaled weight list locally. So then finally, what we are doing is, after all the 10 epochs have been, because 10 clients we have, 10 epochs have been completed, we will average the weights now. So this is what our will become our global weight now. Set weights as the average weights now. Now with this global weight, we will be testing our model now. So this is the actual flow what we follow in case of a federated learning. So it's very simple. Now for demonstration, we have what we have done here is, we have taken a data and we have divided that into 10 different splits, and individually we have modeled it. Instead, what we have to do is this step, right? In this process, if we are running this one, what we will be doing is, so this we will be pushing, right? This we will be communicating to the client actually. After creating the model, right? Setting the weights, global weights, right? So instead of locally running this fit, right? Here we are running in all the fit in the same place. So what we will do is, we will pass on this local model, right, along with the global weight to the client. The client will return the local weights. Then we will estimate the scaling factor. We will calculate the weighted scale the weights. Then we will save it for the client one. Likewise, client two, client three, individually we will save it. So once we got response from all the 10 clients, then we will do this averaging, right? So this is what actually a federated learning will do. This mechanism we follow to only preserve the privacy of the client's data when we want to curate a large volume of data from individual users of an application. So any queries on this one or the program part? So thank you all, right? Thanks for your patience, right? So hope I didn't have any interruptions in between, but unfortunately due to the power cut, I have to just pause the session for 2 minutes, and then I arrange for an interim power source. If you have any queries in future also, please let me know through email, right? I leave my email ID here. So thank you all. Thanks to the organizing team for a wonderful opportunity. Anyone from the organizing team, can we wind up the session or?
Participants, if you have any questions, you can ask, or otherwise we'll wind up for the session. I think there are no questions, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for sparing your time and giving such an informative session for the participants. Most of the participants are benefited out of your session. Thank you so much for being part of this FDP, sir. Thank you.
Thanks for the opportunity. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.